Please come in and take a seat. We're having a very exciting plenary here. So hello everyone, my name is BENTE KLARLUND PEDERSEN and I'm chairing this session, and I have really looked forward to listening to this session myself on personalized exercise oncology. Today we have two distinguished speakers. We have Professor Catherine SCHMITZ and Professor Joachim WISKEMANN, who will share with us their research and views on exercise and cancer guidelines. As many of you may know, we have epidemiological studies demonstrating that a physical active lifestyle is associated with lower risk of up to 13 different cancers. But we also know during the past few years that there are a number of observational studies that show that you actually increase your chances of survival if you start exercising after the diagnosis of cancer. This will have a statistically higher chance of survival compared to those who are physically inactive. We also know that physical activity both during and after treatment can increase quality of life. So how do we implement exercise and cancer guidelines? This is what we're going to discuss during this plenary session. It's my privilege to introduce the first speaker. Our first speaker is Professor Catherine SCHMITZ, who is a professor of public health sciences at the Pennsylvania State University College of Medicine. Professor SCHMITZ has led many exercise trials. She has also translated her work into clinical practice. She has published over 230 peer-reviewed scientific papers. And she was the lead author of the first ACSM roundtable on exercise for cancer survivors, which published guidance for exercise testing and prescription for cancer survivors in July 2010. In June 2017, she became president-elect of the American College of Sports Science. She assumed the presidency in June 2018. And as of June 2019, she became ACSM's immediate past president. In March 2018, Dr. SCHMITZ chaired an international multidisciplinary ACSM roundtable on exercise and cancer prevention and control. The physician, outpatient rehabilitation specialist, researchers, and exercise professionals in the room broadly agreed it's time for exercise oncology to go prime time now. The question is how. Dr. SCHMITZ's professional mission is to answer that question, and we look very much forward to hearing your talk. Welcome.
That's a really long way. Good morning. I bring you greetings from the American College of Sports Medicine. I also bring you greetings from 40 people who spent 2 days in a very, very intensive set of sessions in March of 2018 for the International Multidisciplinary Roundtable on Exercise and Cancer Prevention and Control. And in the name of those 40 folks, I have a caution and a request as we begin this session. So the work shared here is either under review or recently accepted and embargoed at a journal. And so please do not take any photographs or share this information until you see it come out in journals, hopefully this October or November. Thank you very much for your consideration. So this slide and some of the others in my talk are actually borrowed from my co-presenter, Joachim WISKEMANN. And he actually has a few of my slides as well, so we could give each other's talks, I'm pretty sure, and probably argue about which slide was the better slide. But anyway, he put together this slide in preparation for our roundtable, and It really is. I think I need to put this in presentation mode, don't I? So you guys see this. Now you see it, don't you? No? Eventually they'll find it. There it is. Now we're there. So this slide, put together by JOACHIM WISKEMANN, shows the exponential growth in the field of exercise oncology from the 1990s to the present day. But in particular, I'll note to you that there was a 281% increase in randomized controlled trials on physical activity and cancer between the publication of the first ACSM roundtable guidance in 2010 and 2018 when we held the second roundtable. That indeed was why we felt it was time to do this roundtable. So it occurred in March of 2018 in San Francisco, and this time we decided that there were a number of things we wanted to do differently than the first roundtable. The first roundtable really focused on side effects of cancer and whether exercise was useful for side effects of cancer and whether it was safe. This time we decided we wanted to be multidisciplinary, and so we included outpatient rehabilitation professionals, oncologists, rehabilitation medicine doctors, nurses, and policy folks, as well as basic scientists and epidemiologists and clinical trialists. We included partner organizations from across the United States and across the world, including from Canada, the UK, Australia, the Netherlands, and Germany. Three papers will result from the roundtable. The first paper is called the American College of Sports Medicine Roundtable Report on Physical Activity, Sedentary Behavior, and Cancer Prevention and Control. I will be presenting a summary of that paper to you today. The second paper is the update from the original guidelines and is focused more on other cancer health-related outcomes other than cancer itself or death itself, and is called Exercise Guidelines for Cancer Survivors, a consensus statement from an international multidisciplinary roundtable. The third paper will be discussed by JOACHIM WISKEMANN in the second presentation today and is called Exercise as Medicine in Oncology, Engaging Clinicians to Help Patients Move Through Cancer. The first two papers are under submission at ACSM's flagship journal, Medicine, Science, Sports, and Exercise, and the third paper is under submission at CA, a journal for clinicians, which is one of the flagship journals of the American Cancer Society. So why are we doing this? In this particular setting, in getting to talk to this audience at ECSS, and it's much the same at ACSM, this is an audience that grew up on understanding the role of exercise for the cardiovascular system. We understand the effects of sports on the metabolic system. We may even understand the effects of exercise on the reproductive system. But was there a course in your program when you got your undergraduate, graduate, or postdoctoral training on exercise and cancer? There probably wasn't. And so there's a little bit of a primer needed to just understand the potential for us to have an effect on this very important disease. There are 18 million diagnoses of cancer worldwide every year, and 9.6 million people die of cancer every year around the world. Cancer is thus the second leading cause of mortality in the world. The lifetime risk of cancer in the U.S. is 40% in men, 38% in women, and the annual cost of cancer care in the United States is $158 billion, and that's the direct cost of the actual care for the cancer itself, not the additional indirect costs, which are more than double that. As a result of the recognition of cancer being something of tremendous burden, and as a result of recognition that our first roundtable did not take it head on, we chose to expand the second roundtable to review and summarize the biologic and epidemiologic evidence for the role of physical activity across the cancer prevention and control continuum. So to look at cancer as an outcome and mortality as an outcome as well. We did this first paper in a backdrop of a number of other things that had been done recently as well. In the United States, 10 years ago, and then just last year again, we had a physical activity guidelines advisory committee that came together and they were gathered on behalf of the United States Department of Health and Human Services to review the entirety of the literature on the issue of physical activity and health, and they included cancer in their review. And so there was a review that had been done for the federal government. There was also, of course, the World Cancer Research Foundation, or Fund, the review that had been done just a year before our roundtable occurred. There had been a number of different pooling projects and meta-analyses as well. So our goal with putting together our consensus statement was to draw on each of these sources in order for us to be able to make conclusions and make recommendations going forward about the types of cancer for which we might expect a prevention effect from being more physically active, and the types of cancer for which, if we are more active after cancer, we might prevent cancer-related and overall mortality. But this is an interesting area of study, because unlike some of the other areas that you'll read about, some of the work that I heard, fascinating work that I heard yesterday's plenary on springs and sprinters, where we're looking at very short-term outcomes, this is a long-term outcome. It's not dissimilar from exercise and heart disease in one way, and that is we're never going to be able to have a primary prevention randomized controlled trial that will show that physical activity prevents heart disease. It's never going to happen. The study would take too long and would be too big, right? So the same thing is true with exercise and cancer. And so what do? Well, we can look to the bright, incredible epidemiologists that worked in the area of smoking and lung cancer back in the 1950s, including Sir Bradford Hill, who, when criticized by tobacco companies, who said, you don't have any causal evidence that there is any association between smoking and lung cancer because you haven't done a randomized controlled trial, he and other brilliant epidemiologists came together and developed a set of criteria by which scientists might be able to decide whether the evidence base does indeed give reason for saying that there is a causal link between an exposure, physical activity, and an outcome, cancer, in a situation where it is not possible or feasible to do a randomized controlled trial. So there are eight of them. Number one, temporality. Does the cause precede the effect? Does the physical activity precede the disease? Plausibility. Is the association consistent with existing knowledge? Do we know other body systems for which this might be true? Three, consistency. Have similar results been shown in other studies? And this is a very important thing for you to look at as we go forward and I show you the evidence base in this area. If we see one study in an area, we're not going to make a broad sweeping conclusion. But if we see 25 studies and they come together and show us a 30% reduction in risk, then we start to say the preponderance of evidence would indicate that there is a causal association, right? Then there's the strength. What is the strength of the association between the cause and the effect? If we see a 2% reduction of risk, we're not as impressed as a 30% reduction in risk. And then there's dose response. Does increased exposure to physical activity relate to decreased exposure to the likelihood of the cancer? The next one is reversibility. Does removal of the cause decrease risk of the effect? We don't have this one. This is the one that we will not have any evidence for in the area of exercise oncology at present. Then there's study design. Is the evidence based on robust study design? So there is a hierarchy of study designs that we would look at in science. The least robust would be an ecologic study, then cross-sectional, then case control studies, and then prospective cohort studies, which is where the majority of the work is in exercise oncology. And then, of course, the creme de la creme would be a randomized controlled trial, which I've already said we can't get in this situation. And then evidence, how many lines of evidence lead to this conclusion? This one I want you to, in your own mind, put together what I'm able to show you about the biological plausibility and the mechanistic underpinnings with the observational epidemiologic literature and draw your own conclusion. So with that as a backdrop, there are a number of different possible causes of cancer. They go into two, arguably two buckets. One bucket might be called the key enabling factors. These are things that might predispose a person to develop cancer. The key one there being genomic instabilities, particularly in key growth regulator genes, but in addition, a backdrop of tumor-promoting inflammation that might exist because of metabolic dysregulation. There are also acquired capabilities that might occur because of exposure to things like physical activity or smoking or other carcinogens, including cell proliferation, apoptosis, angiogenesis, metabolic control, immune response in particular, whether the person has the ability to evade immune control, whether the tumor is stronger than the immune system, and finally, invasion and metastasis. So there are a number of different types of studies that have been done that have explored biological plausibility for a link between exercise and cancer. I am summarizing these in two slides. I am not able to give examples because of the nature of the length of this talk. I'm trying to give you a bird's eye view, and I hope that you will look for paper number one as it is published, hopefully, October and November. But four different types of studies that have been done in the area of mechanistic link between exercise and cancer start with the circulating biomarker studies. These might be seen as the weakest of the evidence. And what we might do here is randomize people to exercise versus not exercise and see whether we see a change in circulating biomarkers that are in the purported link between exercise and cancer. Things about metabolism, things about growth factors, things about immune factors. And then at another level, we might actually look at the specific tissues. We might actually do tissue biopsies or imaging within specific tissues, such as in my own work, where we randomized young women who had a BRCA gene, and we had them do either no exercise, low or high intensity exercise over time, and we did MRIs with contrast to look at the estrogen-specific tissue in their breasts to see whether there was a dose-response effect of exercise on the estrogen-specific tissue within their breasts. The answer was yes. Then there are preclinical models. So we do have a number of researchers, not nearly enough, by the way, researchers who do animal model studies to look at the effects of exercise on the development of tumors, on growth of tumors, and on metastasis or death from a tumor disease in animal models, including mice. And finally, there are secondary prevention trials. There actually have been a couple of secondary analyses of completed trials, including one by Dr. Wiskeman and several by a researcher in Canada, Carrie Cornier, which have been really promising to show when you follow people over a 10-year period after they're done with your randomized controlled trial, that indeed we find that the people who were randomized to the exercise intervention are more likely to survive their cancer than the people who were randomized to the control group. But that's a secondary analysis, that's not a primary analysis, and so we do have ongoing trials in the area of secondary prevention. They are not completed yet. Watch this space. This is going to be a very exciting time as some of these very, very large trials that are being done around the world will be completed, and we'll be able to see finally some randomized controlled trial evidence in this space. So just to give you a very, very broad strokes overview, the idea here is that a sedentary individual has metabolic dysregulation and low-grade inflammation, and thus you can see within the circulation, which is the middle of the slide, that there's a lot going on there that looks quite different from the right side of the slide, where the person is trained. And as a result, you might have an overwhelm of the immune system, a weakened immune system, and the thus ability of a tumor to invade distant tissues and grow to metastasis. With acute exercise, we know that even with a single bout of exercise, we have alterations in the metabolic milieu and potentially changes in the way that some of our body systems would respond and potentially protect us from metastasis. But what we're really interested in is what's on the right side of the slide, which is the trained individual who obviously is thinner as well, and this person is going to have a better working cytotoxic immune system and a more regulated metabolic system, and these are expected to protect us in a variety of ways that I'm not able to get into because of time today, from the development of tumors, but in addition, it alters perfusion of the tumors themselves. It actually alters, and many people in the room probably already know, that we can change the density of our capillaries by being more aerobically, physically active. It turns out that occurs within tumors as well, which might alter our ability to deliver chemotherapeutic drugs. So now I'm going to switch to the epidemiologic evidence. There's a variety of ways for us to look at this. We can look at people who've never had cancer, and we can follow them over decades in a prospective cohort study and look at whether they develop cancer, whether they die of that cancer. We can also look in people who've already had cancer and see whether differences in physical activity before they ever had their cancer result in differences in whether they die of their cancer or whether they die of something else. We can also look at what happens with if they change their physical activity after their diagnosis. Does that make a difference as well? Those are not all the same question. Those are independent questions. And hearkening back to the slide that I spent some time on, the Bradford Hill criteria, we also want to look at dose response. We also want to look at the type of exercise and maybe the timing of exercise as well. Does it matter whether you're more active as a child or over the lifetime? I'm not able to get into this kind of detail again today. I just want to make you aware of the fact that this detail exists and does support the hypothesis that exercise has an effect on some tumor sites. So, for physical activity and primary cancer prevention by cancer type, we are able to conclude for 7 different cancer types that there is a statistically significant reduction in the likelihood of being diagnosed of any one of these cancers for those who are most physically active compared to those who are least physically active. And the range of the effect is from a 28% reduction for esophageal cancer to the smallest is a 12% reduction in the likelihood of developing kidney cancer for those who are most versus least active. I'll also point out to you the number of studies. So think back to that Bradford Hill criteria. This is consistency of evidence across a large body. In addition to that, I'll also point out to you that there are 2 types of physical activity noted on this slide. Leisure time physical activity, which is where we have preponderance of evidence, but then we also have evidence for occupational, household, transportation, and walking. So on this slide, we have leisure and the occupational evidence, and we're able to draw conclusions for colon, breast, and endometrial cancer, not just for leisure time physical activity, but also for those who are most active in the occupational category compared to least active. When we look at household, transportation, and walking activity, what you can see is a slide that has a lot of dashes. So we don't have nearly as much evidence in this area. We do have 21 studies that are able to tell us that there's a 22% reduction of the likelihood of the development of breast cancer for women who are most active in the household activity area compared to those who are least active. For colon cancer, there is a 34% reduction of the likelihood of the development of colon cancer for those who are most versus least active in the transportation area. And for breast and endometrial cancer, walking specifically appears to be helpful. And once again, I'll point out the number of studies there. 5 studies for breast, 10 studies for endometrial. So that's a really shining, wonderful underscore of saying that, yes, we really do have an effect for primary prevention in those cancers. There's one notable exception. A number of the analyses, including ours, concludes that there is actually an increased risk for one cancer by being more physically active, and that is melanoma. The hypothesis is that this is because people are more active outside and thus they have more sun exposure, but we don't actually know. And so in the US, the National Cancer Institute is supporting studies to try to ensure that this is in fact the case, as well as to very interested in dissemination studies for sun safety for those who are physically active. And I would commend this information to those of you that work with youth sports in particular, that you really work on sun safety with your teams. I'm only going to spend just a moment on this slide, just simply so that you can see the difference between this and the next slide, which is about post-diagnosis physical activity. So there are a number of rows for which we are able to say those who were more physically active prior to their diagnosis of cancer are less likely to die of their cancer if they had breast, colorectal cancer for cancer-specific mortality, and breast, colorectal, and prostate cancer for all-cause mortality. And that's where we have the preponderance of evidence, and the bottom half of the slide, really we only have one study at a time for the other outcomes. But for the post-diagnosis physical activity, I'd really like to highlight for you that there are three cancer sites for which we have some pretty astounding evidence in terms of the strength of the association, the consistency of the evidence, the biological plausibility, many of the factors that I pointed out from that Bradford Hill criteria that I noted early in my talk. What I'll point out to you is that for breast, colorectal, and prostate cancer, both cancer-specific and all-cause mortality is reduced by 30% or more. And if you look at the number of studies, we're not talking about one or two studies here. This is consistent evidence across the field. There are a number of sites for which we have promising evidence, but note that it's one study at a time. And so while it is impressive to see that for non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, there's almost a 50% reduction in cancer-specific mortality, that's from one study. So let's not draw any major conclusions quite yet for that. To summarize, we have met 7 of the 8 Bradford Hill criteria in the area of physical activity in primary and secondary cancer prevention. For primary prevention, the sites that we show, we have a statistically significant anywhere from 28 to 12% reduction of risk are breast, colon, endometrial, kidney, bladder, gastric, and esophageal cancers. Some of these sites are prevented by a variety of different types of activity, and I've not shown it to you, but there are dose-response effects for some of these sites as well, where we have the evidence. For prevention of cancer-specific and overall mortality for those already diagnosed with cancer, we have post-diagnosis leisure time activity evidence for an almost 30% reduction of the risk of dying of breast, colon, or prostate cancer, and a larger than 30% reduction of risk for overall mortality for those survivors as well. Switching rather abruptly now to our focus in paper 2 on the side effects, the other cancer health-related outcomes, because cancer patients are not, and we are not just interested in whether someone develops cancer or whether someone dies of cancer, but there's also the issue of living with that cancer, and there are a whole host of adverse effects of treatment and adverse effects of the cancer itself that must be lived with once the cancer is diagnosed. So we are particularly interested in whether there is the opportunity for us to prescribe exercise with the kind of specificity that we might for cardiovascular disease outcomes. Can we be specific with regard to frequency, intensity, time, and type of exercise? We did this work borrowing from the Dutch physical activity guidelines fit decision tree. We started with reviewing randomized controlled trials and looked at whether there were 5 or more versus not, and whether the evidence was strong within those or not, how many people were in the trials or not, and on off to the right side. And if we had strong evidence, then we were able to do a fit prescription. We also made a fit prescription for the moderate evidence. So let me show you what we had strong, moderate, and insufficient evidence for. So in the strong category, we're able to say that for anxiety, depressive symptoms, fatigue, health-related quality of life, lymphedema, and physical function, we're able to write a fit prescription, a very specific frequency, intensity, time, and type of activity that will have a measurable change in these outcomes for cancer patients during and after treatment. Bone health and sleep, we have moderate evidence for these, but in the area of cardiotoxicity, chemotherapy-induced peripheral neuropathy, cognition, falls, nausea, pain, sexual function, and treatment tolerance, or chemotherapy completion rate, we are unable to write a fit prescription. These are areas that we need more study. So I'm not able, given time, to go through how we went through this review and what the evidence base looks like for each one of these outcomes. But I want to give you an example of what the evidence looks like for at least one of these outcomes. So I'm choosing to use fatigue because it has such a high prevalence rate of 90 to 100% during chemotherapy. There are over 200 randomized controlled trials in the literature on exercise and cancer-related fatigue. This is indeed the largest evidence base in the area of exercise oncology. And the results are available for a variety of different cancer entities, treatments, timing, and exercise approaches. The overall effect size from one very large pooling project in which both Dr. Wiskeman and I participated was 0.32, so a moderate effect size. What they noted that is of particular interest is that patients with higher levels of fatigue tend to benefit the most. The effects are not influenced by what type of cancer they looked at it in, the presence of metastases, treatment status, delivery mode, delivery setting, type of exercise, duration, or other methodological parameters. Further, in one really stunning publication that came out about 2 years ago, there was a comparison of the effect of exercise on cancer-related fatigue with a weighted mean effect size of 0.3 to pharmacological interventions, 0.09, so a threefold effect of exercise over any kind of drug treatment for cancer-related fatigue. And what you can see is that for psychological interventions, it was almost the same, but not quite as large as for exercise interventions. So to sum up, both aerobic exercise and or resistance training seem to positively affect fatigue, but the combination is probably the best. It is stable, the effect is stable against modifying factors and effects foreseen for general and overall fatigue, as well as for subscales of quality of life surveys on physical fatigue. There is a range of fit prescriptions that were used in all of the studies, the hundreds of studies that have been done in this area. This is not what we're recommending. We're just noting that there is quite the range. And one thing that's interesting in the field of exercise oncology is we really are kind of constantly looking for sort of the lowest effective dose, because this is a population that is particularly difficult to get moving. So our fit prescription is the way that we like to go at the American College of Sports Medicine, and I think around the world, and we like to be very specific, using exercise very much like a drug, dosing it like a drug for specific outcomes. But there are limitations in this particular field of exercise oncology. The first is that there is a difference between what is reported as the prescription in a randomized controlled trial and what is reported as the actually having been done by the patients in the trials. What we find is that the same is true for prostate cancer. And so while we say that these are studies that did three times a week, for an hour, walking, the patients may not have actually done that dose, but we know what they prescribed. So it's very similar to the situation of randomized controlled trials for drugs. We also know that the majority of the evidence in the area of exercise oncology actually comes from studies that have been done in breast cancer patients. And so that brings to mind the possibility of the question of whether that knowledge is truly transferable. If we find that there is a measurable effect of an exercise intervention on cancer-related fatigue in breast cancer, can we then say that the intervention would work equally well in lung cancer patients? It's a big question. So I'm not giving you those as a way of taking away the strength of our evidence. I'm trying to let you know that this is an active field that has come a very long way in the past decade, but we still have plenty of way to go. And so those interested in this field should please come join the party. There's a lot to do in exercise oncology. So this is where we were in 2010. The guidance in 2010 was to avoid inactivity, to do at least 150 minutes a week of aerobic activity, twice weekly strength training with all of the major muscle groups, and daily stretching. It was based on the Physical Activity Guidelines Advisory Committee report from the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services back in 2008. Now, we're about to publish new guidelines, and what they're going to say is to avoid inactivity. So we are able to keep those first two words. We think that those are important because still, in many places in the world, when you hear that someone has cancer, the first thing that they're going to say is rest, take it easy, don't push yourself. And we are trying to erase that and make the first two words be avoid inactivity. We think that there's probably less time needed for management of certain symptoms than 150 minutes a week, which is great news because people might actually be willing to do the amount needed for the management of their symptoms. We do see over and over again that the combination of aerobic activity and resistance training gives the best results, and we are able to do a fit-based prescription for very specific outcomes. So if a patient comes and says, what's really bothering me is my fatigue, we're able to give them a very specific prescription. If they come to us and say, I am depressed, and this is, you know, what I really need to focus on, we are able to give them a fit prescription. But I will also tell you that when we put together the table of what the fit prescriptions look like and what the range of fit prescriptions and the average fit prescription looked like across the seven outcomes for which we had strong evidence, the fit prescription looked quite similar, and this is what it was. Avoid inactivity. Aerobic exercise three times weekly, up to 30 minutes, but 20 minutes is sufficient. Resistance training, one set, 8 to 12 reps, twice weekly, major muscle groups. But there was no comment on flexibility activities because there's not an evidence base for us to be able to rely on. And with that, I will thank you so much for your attention, and I will thank you in particular on behalf of the 40 folks that spent two very intensive days together in March 2018. Thank you.
Thank you very much for sharing these exciting data with us. I learned a lot. So our second speaker is Joachim Wiskemann. He holds a PhD in sports and exercise science, as well as in sports psychology. He's employed at the National Center for Tumor Diseases in Heidelberg, and he also has a chair in at the state of Penn State University. As head of the working group Exercise Oncology at Heidelberg University Hospital, and as a PI of several exercise intervention trials in cancer patients, he has substantial experience in planning exercise programs to cancer patients. Dr. Wiskemann published landmark studies in the field of exercise and cancer and provided new insights into the exercise oncology in a variety of cancer entities. I could go on, but in the interest of time, I think we should let you speak for yourself. Welcome.
Thank you very much for this kind introduction, Bente, and thank you very much for the organizers of these ECSS conference to choose such a plenary session on exercise oncology, which is a great honor for the whole topic, as well as for me to present here. And as Katie SCHMITZ was presenting, fit prescription evidence and evidence from randomized control trials and evidence from observational trials, I'm going to focus a little bit more about what can we do with these results and what are problems, caveats, and translating this evidence into practice. So I will focus on implementation of exercise and cancer guidelines in Europe. So my goal would be, first of all, to focus a little bit on some general considerations on this topic and then ending up with some examples from three different European countries showing how exercise is implemented there or what kind of programs are implemented there and what the problems are and what the results from evaluation studies are on these programs. So starting with the first aspect, so some general considerations, and I would like to focus on these aspects here. So looking again a little bit on efficacy, but mostly on safety, because that's a really interesting part if you try to translate randomized control trials into practice. Then a little bit on what kind of guidelines are available and what do we really need. Even with perspective to the stakeholders in the field, like healthcare professionals who will play a key role in delivering or even counseling cancer patients with regard to exercise, and then those who have to do the exercise with the patient, so the exercise specialists, a little bit on infrastructure as well as on triage and identification of the patients. So start with safety and efficacy and focusing on the beginning of safety, and which is a little bit crazy if you remind yourself about the slide from Katie Schmitz at the beginning. We have evidence on the efficacy of exercise in cancer patients till the end of the 1980s. So not much, but it started somewhere there. And if you're looking at specific studies focusing on safety, there are coming meta-analyses and reviews up in the recent times. So 2017, if you're looking at these various publications here, which looks a little bit odd. So why are those people are interested in safety? It's proven if you're looking into the studies. But I tell you the answer on this question. It's easy. The people who were reading these randomized control trials were trying to implement the results and the exercise intervention from those randomized control trials, and they learned it's not that easy as prescribed in the randomized control trials. That it's not only the reality for cancer patients, but it's a big challenge for cancer patients because we have those inclusion and exclusion criteria in the randomized control trials, and we have a highly selective population of cancer patients, mostly in the randomized control trials. And if you open a program for every cancer patient in your facility, you might focus very different patients. So just picking one of these review articles and looking a little bit more into detail. So, and I choose the one where we have the most evidence from randomized controlled breast cancer trials. And this trial was, this review analysis was just looking at whether they were reporting adverse events and saying no, there were no adverse events, or even adverse events were not reported, which is really different. And if you're looking at the results, 41% of the trials were reporting explicitly that no adverse events had occurred. Great. However, 34% were not reporting on adverse events. They were not mentioning it. And 25% were reporting adverse events, which is a good number. And it's even important to say that there were no difference regarding the risk of adverse events. They used a certain classification criteria, which is used in drug development studies. I'm not going that much into detail, but there were a slight tendency that a little bit more adverse events occurs in exercise patients, but it was not statistically significant, and it was not influenced by exercise mode or whether the intervention was supervised or not, or taking place during or after treatment. And it's even just in breast cancer patients who were not advanced cancer patients, and this is the next field, and these are the most complex cancer patients, I guess, and there is not that much evidence out there. However, there are some studies, some were reporting minor adverse events, but really mild and mostly musculoskeletal aspects. There were a lot of death, but not related to the exercise interventions. And if you're looking a little bit more into detail into the studies, I just grabbed one out here from Morten Quist from Denmark, from advanced lung cancer patients. They were excluding a lot of patients in the beginning due to exclusion and inclusion criteria for just an example here, pain, dizziness, or fever. So those patients might show up in a local exercise program, and there are not represented in current randomized control trials right now. So let's do the reality check. And I would like to make a case example with you. So who of you is working in the field of exercise oncology? Raise your hands. Okay, not that much. Okay. But you're working in sometimes with patients, I guess, or even with athletes. I would like to have your opinion on this. So this is a case example from a real existing patient having a, let's say it's a cancer in the lung and with pulmonary metastases. It's a female, 77 years old. Are any one of you concerned about exercising with this patient? Raise your hands if yes. No one. I'll give you some more information. The patient has osteoporosis, current state after multiple rib fractures. Who has concerns? Exercising. Oh, some hands are coming up. Some are working in the field of osteoporosis and bone health. Okay. So what about some more information? The patient is wearing a corset using crutches due to unstable bone metastases in various locations, even having a pathologic fracture in the lumbar spine, L1, and is going to be treated under radiotherapy for those metastases. Who is concerned about safety of exercise? Wonderful, some of them, but most not. And I tell you, you should be concerned however exercise is possible, but it would not look like the general recommendation, like doing 30 minutes of aerobic training or at least 2 times a week, 8 to 12 repetition maximum training with this patient. But it's possible to exercise, and I would like to share with you a video. This is the woman. She's dropping off her corset, and she's supported by a therapist and to get on the floor and to get exercises done, which helps to stabilize the muscle areas around the bone metastases. And the patient was able, and a lot of patients are able, to do really impacting exercise, as you see here. The plank, it's not perfectly done, so please excuse the patient. And what we've learned during treating those patients, it's more an issue we were more concerned regarding pathological fractures by bringing the patients on the floor and getting them up than during the exercise interventions. So it's really important to make this happen, to also educate those patients that they are able to follow the exercise interventions. And that's something which is really important, I guess, for future studies. So lab studies are really fine, but we more and more need studies who are having the approach to translate the interventions, and you see this here, to educate the patients to follow the exercise program on their own. This is the patient 3 weeks later, and she's now able to get on the floor on her own and coming up. Treatment was finished at that time, but still metastases were there. So this is something we really need, and we really need to consider if we are translating randomized control trials into practice. We have those patients in reality, even if they are not included in studies. And even what we do not have is data from routine exercise programs that are currently existing. How often do a serious adverse event or a non-serious adverse event occur? And we did a quick and dirty questionnaire-related survey this year, and we used over 200 resources and addresses we had from training centers and asked them how often did such an event occur in 2017, and these are the results. So there were a lot of questionnaires coming back, but not that much. So as I told you, we approached about 200. 34 were answering us from 12 countries. We had data about 90,000 patient hours, and 672 adverse events occur. 10 were severe adverse events, 6 occurred during aerobic training, which was interesting, and were mainly related to falling from the treadmills. And this is a typical intervention from randomized controlled trials, dealing with the patients, training with the patient on the treadmills. So we should be aware of that. The other 662 non-severe adverse events, it's pretty safe. We can say that when we are transforming this to 100,000 patient hours, and there were no they were equally distributed, so no association with the exercise mode or other training types. So what we can say from that is we have a majority of evidence that exercise is safe in the randomized control trials. However, we should be aware of that it's mostly coming from breast cancer patients, and that randomized control trials have selective inclusion and exclusion criteria, and we definitely need more ideas how the exercise intervention can be translated into reality. So we need more of those projects I was presenting you before. So shortly on efficacy, Katie was telling you a lot on that. I was just focusing on quality of life and mention, I guess, one of the very important leading project and a great project which is led here in Europe by the Polaris group in the Netherlands by Laureen Buffard. This is a review, and we have also, and this is the important thing on quality of life, we have also individual patient data of 34 randomized controlled trials. I have to admit that most of the studies included are coming from the US, but it's a European initiative, and that's wonderful. And we are able to draw very good conclusions regarding the fit criteria from this. So what Katie was also including is we have the high quality RCT evidence, we have the observational evidence, we know that exercise is safe but should be tailored according to the patients, so we should prescribing it, we should prescribe a way how to do it. Even having in mind that we have problems with the fit principle, Katie was referring to that. So what's the way to communicate fit prescriptions or what kind of exercise is should be done with cancer patients? Guidelines, writing guidelines. And as you know, there are a couple of guidelines out there. The first roundtable was in 2009 and published in 2010. There were echoes from American Cancer Society or NCCN saying the same like the 2010 guideline. And just to remind you, Katie was showing it, it's quite unspecific. However, it was a guideline, but the guideline is the same like for healthy people. There are new things going on, and one of the new things was that the Australian Society of Clinical Oncology, COSA, was publishing last year the first guideline which was created for medical oncologists and nurses. And they were forcing medical staff to see or to recognize exercise as an embedded part of standard care for cancer patients. And all members of the multidisciplinary cancer team were forced or even encouraged to promote physical activity for those patients. This is the next step, and this is very good. However, this is just, again, recommending the general advice from 2010, and I guess what we need next is a more detailed prescriptions for physicians and clinicians, like clinical treatment pathways look like. So there is an exposure to a symptom. What should you do? What is the exercise prescription look like? Please recommend this. And that's going on with regard to the round table, and Katie was telling you that. We think that in autumn we will have the papers out there. But which is much more important, because it's again coming from the ACSM, but also there are clinicians included, is that those guidelines would be echoed, and there should be own versions on it from ASCO, which is the biggest society in the US, and ASMO in Europe, and I can tell you those societies are currently focusing on this guidance and building their own guidance for their medical oncologist, which is a very important step, because we need those to really educate and even convince the stakeholders from the healthcare professional field to promote exercise interventions. Because the current situation is that we have inadequate activity in cancer patients. Less than 25% are really fulfilling the current guidelines. And there are multifactorial causes. I will just focus on those that the healthcare professionals, the nurses, the physicians are not routinely recommending exercise. I guess that's true for a lot of fields. We would love to see physicians and nurses more engaging in healthcare promotion, but this is the on the topic of cancer, and there's really something to do. And what are the reasons? The reasons are quite clear, and evidence-based research show there's a lack of awareness what exercise can really do, what is the potential value. And there is a big uncertainty regarding the safety and suitability. Is my patient able to exercise? The example I was showing you a couple of minutes before, I guess if you're asking 100 medical oncologists, there are only 5 who are saying, okay, let's try to exercise with them. And 5 might be a large number. So there's a lack of awareness about programs, available programs, even sometimes there are no programs. There is a need for education that the oncologists can identify patients and making referrals, and which is also really important, they currently do not believe, because it's not implemented in their guidelines, that it's their responsibility to focus on aspects like exercise and dealing with patients on that. So what we recommend on this is producing easy materials and using the exercises medicine approach to help healthcare professionals to talk to patients about exercise. And there are some easy steps to do that. Just looking at the question one and two, ask the patient about how often do you exercise during the last week with regard to endurance training or aerobic training and resistance training. And if it's not fulfilling the guidelines, then try to advise and refer them, if they could be referred, to a community-based program, or if there are patients at high risk, I will refer to this a little bit later, then advise them to an inpatient or an outpatient rehabilitation service, and repeat this talking about exercise routinely. This is just, these two questions just cost a minute. So, but if this is going to be really happen, if oncology professionals would do that, we need a lot of exercise professionals in the field serving for this population. And the good news is, and this is a very quick and easy work, we have a lot of educational programs, very good, evaluated in nearly each country we are looking at when we are talking about where exercise oncology research has been done. So in Europe, so as an example, in the Netherlands, in Germany, in Canada, in the UK, but also in the US, in Canada. So there are a lot of institutions develop those programs. However, just the example from Germany, there are only about 1,000 therapists educated. So if we see the number of 500,000 cancer cases a year, and even if only 20% of them would be eligible for an exercise program or interested, one therapist has to handle 1,000 cancer patients a year. Impossible. So we need structures in here, and we have to build even structures with regard to the environment, because patients are having clear ideas how exercise delivery should work. So we have a lot of studies on that. Maybe that's not the perfect way, but if you look here, they think it's important to be counseled in that way, and they would like to be counseled by the cancer care team, and then transferred to first a center-based intervention and then downstream to community-based programs. What would that mean? It would mean we have to identify patients who are at need. So screening initiatives. We have to have an exercise oncology team in place in larger cancer centers. This is the need. Or we have to educate all the clinicians and all the nurses, which is another opportunity. We have to have a gym or exercise therapist who are able to deliver interventions in the clinical setting. We have to build networks in a community to refer patients close to their homes. And we have to build non-medical exercise or cancer programs in the community setting if they don't exist. So this is quite challenging, and this is something we are focusing on, and we are trying to get advice how this can be done, and I will show you in a couple of seconds some examples on that. Before that, it's important how to identify and triage those patients, and I've just focused on that on a minute. So screening of cancer patients, in an ideal world, we don't need this. We would counsel every patient, because you see this epidemiological data, observational data, every patient should be counseled except for those who are active enough. But this is, we are not living in an ideal world. We have limited resources. So one opportunity, and that's an example from Heidelberg, could be that you use a screening system, tablet-based, where you ask for certain indications where exercise is evidence-based method to help those patients, or if the patients are expressing subjective interest in exercise counseling. That would be wonderful. And then we need some risk stratification if we found those patients, and we propose three different stages. High risk or advanced cancer patients, they should be referred to an interdisciplinary rehab team with supervised interventions in a physical therapy setting. Moderate risk on a clinic-based setting, also supervised, and it could be informed by physical therapy and exercise professionals, and a low to moderate risk group, which can be referred to community settings. So, or even to telehealth interventions, which is an important opportunity. So, to sum this up, So these general considerations, and then coming to some examples, is we have the safety, we have the efficacy of the intervention of exercising cancer patients. We should address patient's need. We need a systemically identification of patients via three screening programs, and we need the involvement of healthcare professionals to get sufficient referral. This is important. So how has this been done in some European countries? And a big excuse to everyone who's working in the field of cancer here, I know there are a lot of other cancer programs across Europe. I choose those three because those three were involved in the ACSM roundtable. I know there are fantastic rehabilitation programs in Scandinavia, in the south of Europe, in the center of Europe, as well in the east of Europe, but I focus on these three. And from United Kingdom, Anna Campbell was so keen to provide me some slides. And by the way, I put another photo of her with Prince William in here because she was currently honored for her work on cancer patients, which is a really nice sign to see that this work is seen on the political level and that it's regarded as an important thing. So the goal of the program, which is founded by the Macmillan Initiative, is for her to ensure that everyone who's living with cancer and beyond is aware of the benefits of physical activity. Regardless of what type of physical activity they will do and what's right for them, they should be aware of it. They have different programs across the UK. I just pulled out the Northern Ireland Initiative, and it works like there is a coordinator going into the clinic, recruiting patients, talking with the physicians, then counseling them and presenting then a diverse menu, individualized approaches, group-based, cancer-specific, non-specific, and financing them for up to 12 months, and they can follow then in the program if they want on their own cost, or sometimes the community is paying for this program. The very good thing is that the program from the beginning on has included an evaluation project, and I will try to show you some data on that. This is the changes in self-reported physical activity, and which is really nice to see is that they were able, even there were patients in during the treatment process, that about a third or 25%, 30% were able to increase physical activity level, and two-thirds were able to stay at the physical activity level they had before cancer treatment, only a few decreased, and which is also of interest. The biggest increase of physical activity took place during the first 3 months. Then when we are looking at patient-reported outcomes over 12 months, and what you see here is there's a tremendous loss of patients. They started with about 1,000 at the beginning. They have only data of 268 at the end. Positive data. However, you would expect dropping out of this program is not a good, sign. But the program is designed that the patients are educated to follow their own exercise behavior. So a lot of patients dropped out of the program because they were able or felt able to follow the program on their own. So it would be good that they should be, if they had been also evaluated, that was a big backdrop from the study, but this is important to know. Same for fatigue, and which is really impressive for me to see a lot of different activities. So a one-size-fits-all approach, it's not happening. A lot of fatigue, a lot of activities. Then from the Netherlands, shortly, a program or more programs that is led by Martin Stoiver. He is a physiotherapist, and he developed with other colleges called a Recovery and Balance Program in 1996. Group-based, tailored, and having psychoeducation on it. They developed it very well. It was reimbursed, and it is reimbursed by some insurances, so additional insurances, and they disseminate the program over 15 years till 2010. So 68 locations are offering this program, and they are serving about 2,500 participants. They had several evaluations on that. However, they were every time again denied by the government that this program could be reimbursed by basic insurance. 2006 they tried it, 2009 they tried it. The only solution was a political initiative for developing a guideline for oncology rehabilitation. This showed when you're implementing screening, triage, and a modular approach, then exercise could be a cornerstone, but in combination with OTs, with PTs, with other therapists who are involved in specialized cancer rehabilitation. And based on that, if there is a single problem, they are able right now to offer a standardized exercise intervention program after treatment, which is then possible and is covered by insurance if the patient is not able to comply with current guidelines or even achieve the desired activity levels. They also have an opportunity based on scientific evaluations, a very famous PACES study, I guess you know the results from that, for cancer patients during treatment, and the average cost for this program, a combined endurance and exercise program, was $925. Last but not least, some slides from Germany, and then I'm done, and then we are going into discussion. In Germany, we have multifold approaches how patients can benefit from exercise. We have a long tradition in inpatient rehabilitation, which is available for also for cancer patients. It's established since years, and followed by sports club located rehabilitation groups, but they are not linked with clinical oncology sites. And I would like to try to give you an example from oncology site, and I choose my own one, so the NCT in Heidelberg. However, there are other institutions also in Germany doing this, about eight working in this field. The scheme is very easy. You know the screening process before. And we are screening about 4,000 patients with regard to these symptoms where we have evidence that exercise is beneficial. Based on these symptoms, we are discussing the patients in a so-called biopsychosocial tumor board, because the screening not only involved questions regarding exercise, but also questions regarding nutritionists, psycho-oncologists, social workers, and so on. At the beginning of this project, we were then writing a recommendation letter for every patient. This is currently not happening. But it turned out that a short recommendation in person is also fine. And we are then seeing about a half of them in the exercise program, and we have other patients coming from abroad who are interested in the program. This is where how we identify those patients. We are then doing a lot of diagnostics, individually adapted, if it's needed, and then doing a triage and decision-making process on the type of exercise treatment based on, we call it a side effect-orientated exercise pathways. This is nothing different than what we propose from ACSM, fit criteria based on various symptoms or initiating exercise as early as possible when we assume some side effects, like if the patient is undergoing anti-hormonal treatment, this is a high-risk situation for osteoporosis or osteopony. So then we are starting exercising with the patients, doing high-impact training to improve bone mass. So this will be then done in the exercise oncology unit at the NCT, various special training groups and endurance training groups or resistance training groups. We are doing this right now for about 10 years with about 100,000 therapy hours we delivered. And then we are bringing the patient either to a home-based intervention or with exercise manuals or an online training support platform or to a network approach. And I guess that's the future, and that's also what the Dutch people were doing, building networks in the community to have exercise close to their patient homes. And that's something, I guess, we are not building new offers, so these programs are still existing. So they are related to fitness clubs, sport clubs, to existing PT units or inpatient and outpatient rehabilitation centers. And it's just to educate those people that the patients can exercise there. And it's an expanding network, and I guess that's the way how we can solve the situation dealing with all cancer patients and providing them a suitable exercise intervention and exercise counseling. So the take-home message for you, it's quite complex to deal with the implementation of exercise as a standard of care treatment in cancer patients. We know evidence exists, safety is proven. We need to educate the healthcare providers, the oncology care providers, and we need to establish clinical guidelines in the field of the society of those people. We need infrastructure according to patient needs, and we need to successfully implement programs that do exist, and we can use them as a matrix for other centers who would like to work with this topic. So therefore, the future goal would be on the side of the different countries, gain coverage for such programs by insurance. And I would like to use my opportunity here to call for an European initiative on exercise oncology on that. Maybe ECSS might be the platform, but I would like to encourage in Europe the people to come together. Katie would like to say one voice, global impact. I would say one voice, European impact, but it should be a global impact. So thank you very much for your time, and I hope you enjoyed the presentations.
So after two outstanding talks on exercise oncology, I will invite our two distinguished speakers to come up with me and involve themselves in what we call a Socratic dialogue or Socratic debate. The okay. word is yours.
But first we're going to do a folk dance. No. I warned him. So I want to get you to reflect on something that you kind of pointed at, but you didn't say very specifically, but it's there in the middle of what you talked about. And that is that we have, in order to get insurance coverage and in order to make these programs go, the people that we have to convince need to see a level of evidence that is what we have, for example, for fatigue, okay? And they want to see it for outcomes that matter to them, right? And outcomes that are expensive. But what matters to the patients, that's not what matters to the patients. And when we go, when you and I go out to then actually intervene with the woman that you did the beautiful video of, what matters to her and her outcomes is not the same. But then when you're asked to audit your program, you're not addressing the problems that they originally said they would fund your program to do. I'm curious to know, I'm asking you about getting coverage for this. What are you running into and how are you resolving that issue, if you are?
That's a very good question. And I guess the key on that is really patient advocacy. And that's something which is rising a lot in the field of oncology in Germany. So the patients are standing up, saying their word, and they are incorporated in a lot of initiatives, even with regard to research. So they have a chair in several research boards and even in the political import boards to get certain treatments really happen. And I guess we have the evidence. That's clear. However, there are a lot of concerns for insurance companies, so they don't want to raise more money or spend more money on such a program. But I guess if the patients, if we can support the patients to stay up and say loud, we need this, because this is something we can do our own. We can support the treatment situation by our own, and I can contribute to my treatment. It's not just driven by the oncologist. I'm involved, and I need this. I guess that's a important way how we can move forward to get insurance companies and governments convinced to implement and spend coverage on exercise intervention in cancer patients.
Your turn.
Do you have questions for her? Your question.
Yeah. Katie. So that's looking at the evidence you were prescribing us with regard to fatigue. So it looks like when we are going to see evidence in other fields, like other side effects, that maybe programs looking more or less the same, or where exactly do you see the difference with regard to outcomes when you're prescribing exercise personally to cancer patients?
Well, this is where, this actually comes back to my question to you. So, we might have the idea of doing a randomized controlled trial to help with cancer-related fatigue or with bone health or with CIPN or whatever. And people would come in to the program, but what they are interested in may be different than what you decided to do your trial on. And let's just stop for just a hot second here and say, you're talking to someone who is dealing with an existential threat, right? So this is somebody who is, this is not somebody who decided whether or not to get a pedicure. This is somebody who is going through cancer, curative cancer care, who might have a risk to their life. And so what matters to them matters a lot. And so I think we have to meet patients where they are as a result. And so what's lovely is that we have evidence in these nine, you know, seven of them, we have strong evidence, two we have moderate evidence. For the others are coming along, and you know, as that list sort of shifts left so that we can have more and more things that we have the strong evidence for in a broader variety of cancer types, then, you know, when someone comes and says, well, nah, I don't want to exercise, and you say, well, but it could help you with this thing that you care about, then they're interested. So, but right now, our evidence base is still limited. I mean, it's come so far, but it is still limited compared to where I hope it will be by the time your career is over.
Sorry, time is running, and it's time for lunch, but we could have continued. I hope that you will have informal discussions around lunch, and thank you to all of you for coming. Let's give a hand to our distinguished speakers.